If you must blink, do it now. Hey guys, this is Alachia, and this is my review for Kubo and the Two Strings. This is an animated, or partially CGI, but mostly stop-motion puppetry, claymation and whatnot. A lot of 3D printing involved, and it is by Laika Studios, the same people who made Coraline and the Box Trolls. And it's just this beautiful sort of film directed by Travis Knight and written by Mark Hames and Shannon Tindall, where this young boy goes off and tries to find, he has a quest where he has to find the sword unbreakable and the breastplate impenetrable and the helmet invulnerable. And it's just a gorgeous, gorgeous story. I mean, it starts off with this heartbreaking tale of his mother crashing onto this island, saving her baby, which becomes Kubo him. And he goes to the village, and he's always telling these wonderful, gorgeous stories that he's able to tell on his shamisen, which is the instrument with the three strings. And when he plays, these beautiful origami pieces come to life, and he can tell these stories, and it's just so well done. I was enthralled. The music is just gorgeous. And unfortunately, about three quarters of the way through, the film story just falls apart. And it's so heartbreaking to me because everything else leading into it is just gorgeous. It's almost like an acclamation anime. And then about 50% of the way through, it starts to become more Disney Pixar, which is kind of, you know, like when you see a lot of the kids starting to laugh in the theaters at, you know, the sort of basic sort of humor that they do with a lot of slapstick stuff to get kids kind of laughing. And that's fine. But then the very ending is just, the entire ending just doesn't add up. Like, you go on this entire quest with this young boy who's amazing and well voice acted by Art Parkinson, the guy who played Rickon Stark in Game of Thrones. And you have Charlize Theron and Matthew McConaughey and Rooney Mara and Ralph Fiennes as the Moon King. And it's all just so well constructed. It's a beautifully constructed movie. And then, but the plot just at the very end, it just goes to pieces for me, and it becomes so super, I don't know, it takes on this like whole other, like, it's like you're watching a whole different movie. And for me, that just was so, so disappointing, because I thought it was all like adding up to something, and then it was just going to be like this moment where you're like, everything ahas. And instead, everything just like, you know, here we go. Here's the little perfect little package for you. Let me put this little bow on it. Okay, here you go. Here's your ending. And I was just like, what? What? I feel cheated. So while Kubo is masterfully built, well, you know, well constructed, the amount of time and effort they put into crafting this, you know, beautiful movie out of claymation merged with CGI, and then it just, I'm so disappointed. I really wanted to do an A movie this month, but unfortunately I'm going to have to give Kubo and the Two Strings A, B minus. And that maybe seem a little harsh, I think, for a lot of people, because, just because of how well constructed this is. And I'm going to go into spoilers now, so spoilers. So here's the thing. Kubo is this, I guess, a Japanese sort of character. And his mother washes ashore from escaping from something terrible, and the baby is revealed to only have one eye. And Kubo, which is Kubo, and she basically says, you know, your grandfather took one of your eyes. And it just starts off super dire. You know, a lot of consequences at play. His father died protecting him so that his mother could escape. His grandfather took his eye, and he has all these magical powers, you could tell, because he's able to play that shamisen and create beautiful origamis for the town people and tell these amazing epic stories. And everything has so much heart, and his mother is broken. You know, she's definitely broken, and you could tell she basically stares at the sun all day long into the sky across the ocean. and everything's so heartbreaking and beautiful, and he takes care of her, and he has to be home before the sun goes down, which is a kind of a lot of mystery sort of building up. And he goes back home every day before the sun goes down, so he never finishes the tale he tells for the townspeople, which I think was great. It's kind of like a good sort of build up towards, like, where is the story going to go? We don't know, because, like, he hasn't finished the story himself for the townspeople. But his mother sort of comes alive at night, and she tells him epic tales of his father and all these other things that go on, and he reveals those stories to the townspeople, you know, the following day. Of course, one day he doesn't make it back in time before the sun goes down, and that's how the Moon King, his grandfather, is able to find him and track him down. And the mother's two sisters, played by Rooney Mara, come after him, and then she sacrifices, you know, his mother sacrifices himself so he can escape. And then suddenly this monkey charm that he's been carrying around comes alive and starts to try to protect him. And he goes on this journey to go find, you know, the sword and the armor and the helmet, because he thinks those are the things that are going to be the things that ultimately will help him defeat his grandfather and, you know, finally give him safety so he can actually, like, go back and live in peace. But it builds up towards all of that. It builds up towards the quest of finding the armor, finding the sword, finding the helmet. And they eventually stumble across Beetle, who's played by Matthew McConaughey. His voicing was just a little off to me, because I could not stop picturing Matthew McConaughey, because his voice is so strong. I just kept expecting him to be like, all right, all right, all right. And it was a little jarring for it to be Matthew McConaughey, but he still did a really good job, you know, playing the Beetle. And then it turns out that the monkey and the Beetle are actually his mom and dad. You know, his mom used the charm to put her spirit in there, so she's actually the monkey who's been taking care of him along the journey. And the Beetle, who has amnesia, was cursed by the grandfather to lose all his memory. And so he's been traveling all along this time with his mother and father. And then, you know, the sisters come after them, and they both sort of sacrifice themselves in a way to save him. And he finally gets all the armor pieces, you know, the armor and the helmet and the sword. And you think, okay, now something crazy is about to happen. He just lost his mom. He lost his dad. His grandfather's coming after him. He wants to take his other eye, because he believes that the eyes are what you use to, like, look and gaze into someone else's humanity, into their soul. So if you take out, you know, the eyes and you blind a person, then you can truly ascend to the gods, where you don't have the feelings that humans do. And Kubo is just like, you know, my humanity is what makes me powerful. And so he uses his, you know, mother's hair and the string from his father, and then a piece of hair from him, to reconstruct his shamisen and play this song. And then this giant white ball explodes, and these townspeople also, like, come alive from the grave. And then the next thing you know, like, the grandfather is actually turned into a human with one eye missing, and he has no memory, and all the townspeople start to tell him that he's a great man. He was a great man. And that's where I just was like, what happened there? Like, how, like, where did we go from needing all this armor and stuff to become this really badass warrior? And then suddenly he decides to just play a shamisen instead and use it to raise the spirits of the dead to infiltrate this monster with humanity. And then he turns into his grandfather, like a human grandfather. And then at the end, he praised so that the spirits of his mom and dad can be with him while he releases all of the spirits of the dead back into the heavens or whatever. And it just, like, it ends with, you know, his ghost parents kind of, like, with him, and he's smiling. And I just was so, like, confused by that ending. I was just like, what happened? You had this entire, like, you know, lead up, you had foreshadowing, everything kind of going forward with this, you know, all the quest pieces. And then suddenly all he does is play his shamisen, and then the grandfather's defeated. And I just, yeah, that was really tough for me, that ending. And it was one of the things where, like, some people can kind of get over it and just sort of like, oh, but I appreciated everything else. But for me, the entirety of a story is, like, super important. And that ending was just, it just was like, it's just too convenient, too prepackaged. Nothing added up to lead up to there. Nothing foreshadowed where it should have gone in terms of like actually being something where he needed to play a shamisen with the memories of his parents and the memories of like, you know, all human existence being important. And I feel like I almost felt like maybe I missed a part, you know, that I didn't interpret something correctly. And then that's why I just couldn't get on board with the ending. But, you know, otherwise, it's gorgeous. It's well done. It's beautiful. The soundtrack is gorgeous. It's well acted. But, yeah, for me, that ending, oh, man. But, you know, they're the same people who did Coraline. And I love, love, love Coraline. Coraline's, like, one of the best movies. It's up there on my list. I love the darkness of it, the tone of it. I love the sort of kind of occultist nature of it and the creepiness of it. I just thought it was really well done for the, you know, the stop motion animation style that they were trying to do. It really fit well. With this, there was so much merging of CGI and the stop motion that you just got to the point where you're like, well, when you lose that kind of aspect of the artistry of the claymation stop motion, while the craft is still gorgeous and the craft is so respectable, when you merge it so much and composite it with CGI, you start to wonder, why don't you just CGI the whole thing? And that's like a really kind of touchy area, especially with the making of something. And while you respect their craft, you also sit there and go, like at a certain point, you're like, you could have just done all this in CGI. But, you know, there are a couple moments at the very beginning of the film where it felt very stylistic in that stop motion nature. And then towards the end of the film, it went way more into CGI, way more composite work. And then you're just like, well, at that point, you're like, it lost that signature style. So yeah, it's worth checking out if you have kids, I think, or if you just really interested. It's beautifully done, like I said, and the first half of the film is just wonderful and builds up amazing storytelling, and then the ending of the film just for me just fell apart like completely, and I just was like, wow, what is this? This just turned real Disney real quick. All right, guys, thanks for watching, and if you saw this movie and you think maybe I missed the point of something, please feel free to comment below and let me know that I, you know, maybe misinterpreted something. I keep feeling like I did, like maybe there's a cultural miss that I didn't get and that I didn't connect, but yeah, so please feel free to share with me those thoughts if you have any. All right, guys, if you'd like to see more, you can click right here and watch my Sausage Party review, or you can click right here and watch my fan film review of The Jedi's Code. Until next time, see you on the flip side.